Well, amen. Now, wasn't that some wonderful music? The talent, I just baffles me how somebody can be so talented. Thank you all for having me here. This was kind of an unexpected thing. And by the way, thank you for all the hospitality. I've never had a church in the country that has really made as many phone calls and emails to make sure everything was taken care of properly. It was just amazing. And let's see, how many of you were at the last cooking show we did here? Was there a few? Well, that many, that's it? And we had over 200 people at that last cooking show. Isn't that amazing? And so this time, we're hoping to have even more. It's a summer event, so you never know because people are traveling and stuff. But it's really up to you to do some last-minute marketing. You know, go home tonight and tomorrow and do those reminders on Facebook and Twitter and things like that, and you'll be surprised. We've had times where an extra 50 people show up just because they saw it on a social network. So that's a really important thing to do. By the way, Garrett, I love your energy. Did you see this? This guy's on fire. I mean, I plus he had a metaphor from the culinary field, so he's already won me over. But that was great. That was absolutely fabulous. And I'm looking forward to seeing what amazing things you can, that God can do through you with the accomplishments here. We've got to definitely keep him in prayer and constant during this time that you're here. So amen to that. I know a lot of people think I'm going to be giving a health message today, but I'll save that for tomorrow. I want to give you a testimony about what God's done in my life and then give you some of the strategies. I go around the country, so I see some of the weird things that are going on, and I really understand, and I look at different things that Satan is doing. So I wanted to share some of those things with you as well. But let me start with prayer. Amen. Oh, Heavenly Father, well, we thank you so much for bringing us all together today in your holy home. And Father, we just humble ourselves before you. We do ask for the forgiveness of our sins. And we know, Lord, that you are a loving, just God that does forgive us of our sins. And Father, we want to be worthy of being in your presence in this holy home. We thank you so much for purifying us. So use me today, Lord, as I am your servant, and be the words that need to be spoken in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I really love the fact that Pastor Wes talked about forgiveness when he was up here doing the prayer. You would not believe how many times I go around the country, and because I'm out there constantly, but how many times the church will never have one word about asking for God's forgiveness. And I'm like, really? You know, so I was just thankful that you know, you brought that up. And that's why it was bringing my mind up here. In fact, let me go to 1 Kings here, just to give you a little insight here. 1 Kings 14:8. That's where I'm going to go. I've got this in a couple different areas. Actually, this is three times in the Bible, but 1 Kings 14:8 really says it all here. And let's see. This is God talking here. 1 Kings 14:8, and it says, "And tore the kingdom away from the house of David and gave it to you. And yet you have not been as my servant David, who kept my commandments and who followed me with all his heart, only to do what was right in my eyes." Now wait a minute. Here's God saying that David kept all his commandments? Now wasn't David an adulterer? Sent Uriah to the front lines, right? He was a murderer, you know, with the Uriah. And I'm like, so how could God be saying that David kept all his commandments? Three times I found this exact same writing in the Bible. And it just goes to show you that God not only forgives us of all of our sins, he literally forgets every one of our sins. Amen? Yeah, this happened after David had died. And you know, David was always running to the Lord, pleading with the Lord. And God literally forgets every one of our sins. In fact, I know I've got it right here. It's in Isaiah 43:25. And it says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake and will not remember your sins. This is the awesome God that we have. Amen. Now, let me talk a little bit about my culinary career. I grew up in South Dakota. So if you hear that accent, that's from North Dakota, don't you know? That's the way we talk up there, Minnesota, Wisconsin. And went to college over in Tacoma, Washington. And then I went to Las Vegas, Nevada. And long story short, I ended up opening up a casino in Las Vegas. Now, let me tell you, it takes a lot to get a casino in Las Vegas. You've got to go through all these application fees, and it costs thousands of dollars just for the application fees alone. And I did all this with no partners or anything. I just funded it myself. And after the application fees, now they go through this FBI background check. And they were calling my grade school teachers to see what type of character I had. Oh, let me tell you, it is a very in-depth investigation to get a gaming license in Nevada. And of course, after they go through the entire investigation, then you have to appear in front of the review board. And there's this perched up area, with, and there was five people on the panel up there, and you had to go in front of them and confess your sins. Yeah, it was like, oh yes, I did that, and oh yeah, I did that too, yes, yeah, I did that. And as long as you confessed your sins to the review board, you were granted your license. Now, if they found something that you had not put on your application, they will not grant you your license. As long as you admit what you've done. And I could not believe some of these people that were getting gaming licenses with the crimes that they had committed. But as long as they confessed what they did, they got their license. And so there I go. I went and did through all this and got my license to open up a casino. Now, it wasn't one of the big casinos like you'd see, you know, on television. I saw one on the way here, by the way. When we drove here, there was a big casino there. It wasn't one of the big ones, but it wasn't an itty-bitty one. I mean, my dance floor was almost the size of this room. My stage was actually about the same size as this stage. And you could go in my property sometimes at 11 o'clock at night, and I'd have as many people in my casino as you have in here right now. You know, so, and let me tell you, those casino, those slot machines make a lot of money. Sometimes we were pulling like $20,000 a week out of a slot machine. They make a lot of money. And just to let you know, I was actually raised Catholic. I grew up Catholic. I was in a Catholic church. We went to church every Sunday. I was actually the altar boy for many, many years. And then I ended up being taller than the priest. And they finally said, we have got to get somebody shorter up here. So I got paroled from that. And I left the Catholic church the day I left home to go to college. Like 92% of the population. According to the Barna Group, 92% of people leave the faith within 2 years of leaving home. And that's all faiths combined, of course, you know, but 92%, isn't that a staggering number? I think we should just keep them at home. You know, don't let them go. You know, but yeah, so I was part of that 92%. But here I was in Las Vegas with my little casino and, you know, making good money. My job ended up being where I never had to be at the place, even though I spent a lot of time there. You know, but I had a full-time crew, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. My job was to go to other casinos and entice people to come to my property. And I'd sit next to those dollar players, wherever the dollar players were, that's where I would sit. And play the machines and give them free meal tickets. Come on over for a steak dinner, you know. And more often, and take care of the bartenders. And more often than not, you'd see them at my place. That was just part of the business marketing to get people on the property, and we want those big players there. And yeah, I'll tell you what though, I did not feel like that was where God wanted me to be. You know, and God was just kind of knocking at the door saying, hey, I got something better for you. Problem was, I wasn't listening to God. You know, you're living in the high life, driving new sports cars every other day, you know, and whatever you want to buy. And, you know, I just was not gripping onto this. But God started showing me the devastations that were coming out of that casino business. I mean, I had moms coming in with their half-naked kids, looking for their boyfriends or husbands, and oh man, you'd see that tone when they're walking in there. And my whole crew was trained how to deal with it because it happened that often. And we'd take the kids and put them in the kitchen and get them something to eat and then diffuse the fight that's about to start. And let me tell you, women too, in there blowing their paychecks. A lot of them blowing their paychecks before they even go home and feed the family. You know, it's just that way. And God is just knocking at the door saying, Mark, I got something better for you. But I wasn't listening to God. One kid did an armed robbery the day after he blew his paycheck in the slot machines. And my bartender showed me the article in the paper. You know, and God's just saying, hey, you know, it was just really impressing upon me that I don't want to be in this business. And the problem was, I was listening to God, but I wasn't listening to God. Look up the definition of the word listen in the dictionary, okay? One of the definitions of the word listen is actually obedience. Yeah. See, there's a lot of people listening to God with their ears, but they're not listening to God with their actions, doing what God is asking them to do. This is one of our major problems. And back when I was there, we used to do markers where you could sign a marker in the casino and get money. And I had this couple, this senior couple, they were retired, and they would come in and they would get 300 here, 500 there. By the end of the day, they may have lost a couple $1,000s. The next day, the banks would open, they'd get their money, they'd pay me, start gambling again. And they did this for quite a few seasons in quite a few different properties. And they ended up losing everything they had. They lost their retirement. They lost their life savings. They lost their home, their vehicles. Ended up leaving town in a beat-up pickup truck with a camper topper on the back. And I had other casino owners calling me up saying, have you seen these people? They owe us money. I was like, yeah, they owe me money too, but they skipped town. Now, I didn't care about the money because, see, I could give every one of you $100 to play a slot machine on a marker. The $100 went right in the slot machine. It never left the building. Yeah, I can pull it out, give it to you again, now you owe me $200. We could do this all day long. It's actually a strategy that casino owners want a high percentage of people playing on markers because if you win something, you have to pay me first. So now the winnings are not leaving the property. It's all business why you want high marker players. And but God is just impressing upon me. He's like, and thank God that God is persistent. Amen? And I'm telling you, he had a really long arm to be able to reach me in the pit that I was in. And and when they started the credit card machines in the casinos, let me tell you, sales went up. Everybody swiping their credit cards for money. I had my bartender had the swiper, so people could just swipe their credit card and she'd give them money. I didn't think nothing of it. Everybody's swiping their credit cards for cash to play slot machines. And then one day I was back behind the bar doing a liquor count with my bartender, and I hear this lady with my bartender, and she's like, here, see if you can get $10 off this credit card. She was like, no, how about five? And she'd pull another credit card out of her purse. Here, see if you can get $5 off this credit card. I mean, she was literally trying every credit card in her purse to get $5 to play a slot machine. I mean, isn't that horrible? You know, well, that's nothing compared to finding her with a bullet in her head and committing suicide and orphaning three kids. You know, that's what that business does. That's Satan's job, to destroy and rob and kill. I mean, how do you think it felt to be at that funeral? And everybody pointing the finger saying, hey, that's where the money went. You know, well, I never went to a funeral. And I said to myself, you know, am I getting that desensitized by this industry that I never went to a funeral? You don't get casino owners at funerals. It's not our job to wonder what's happening to the people when they leave or where the money's coming from. You know, but I prayed. I prayed and prayed, and I was like, Lord, I know you've got something better for me. What do you want me to do? And he says, get out of this business. And I got out of that business, and I've never been back since. You know, and I had enough money if I needed to take 3 or 4 years off of work. That wasn't a big deal. Get into some other line of work, and ended up getting married. Thought I married Miss Wright, but I did not know her first name was Always. Yeah, I married Miss Always Wright, and long story short, when the money was gone, so was she. And she knew how to save money. I mean, she'd save $100 on that new pair of shoes and save $1,000 on a new car every year and save $10,000 on a house for her parents. Almost saved me right into bankruptcy is what she did. And I ended up so broke, I lived in my car for a couple months till I could get a paycheck. And by the way, my wife Brenda's here. What an absolute blessing it is to have a godly woman in your life. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. I just couldn't do without her. And back then, I noticed that the closer I was getting to God, the farther away she was getting from me. You notice how that happens? The more time I'd spend in prayer, the more time I was spending reading the Bible, the farther away. But yeah, when the money was gone, so was she. And I'll tell you what, living in my car, a lot of people would think, this is just strange. But I knew God was working on me. I was kind of being humbled and chipping away different things in my life. And I said to myself, you know what? I'm going to get even closer to Christ. See, a lot of people, they're tested through their prosperity and their poverty. Look at the richest neighborhoods in the country. They do the least amount of tithing. They have the least amount of churches. Because they're like, what do I need God for? I got everything I need. But then when people hit rock bottom, they give up on God. They're like, oh, we tried it your way. That sure didn't work out. They were testing Christ in a way they should not be testing Him. And I said, I'm going to get even closer. Started spending 15 minutes on my knees every single morning. And let me tell you, 15 minutes on your knees, that is 1% of your day. And if you will just start spending 1% of your day with Christ, He'll change your life. And it doesn't happen in a day or a week or a month. It was week after week, consistency, month after month. You know, reading the Bible every single day, that I got to the point where I had no desires to drink or smoke or gamble or do anything but focus on Christ. And I'm telling you, you just got to take those steps. And so I'm really loving the life that God is creating for me. And I'm watching television. I run across 3ABN. I started going to different churches in Las Vegas. Went to over 200 different churches in Las Vegas. Las Vegas has more churches per capita than any other city in the country. And whatever sins you want, Vegas has a church for you. I finally quit going to church. I said, man, I can't go to these churches. And you know, a lot of them I went to many times, and they would just teach two verses of the Bible. A lot of show churches in Vegas too, big productions and stuff. And I finally quit going to church altogether, after a couple years of going to all these churches. And so for the next couple years, I just stayed in prayer. I stayed studying the Bible, stayed reading the Bible every single day, morning, noon, and night. And I'm running across my television set, and I run across 3ABN. And I'm like watching them, and I'm waiting for the errors, because I'm picking up errors everywhere. And I'm like, and every time, they were just validating what God had spent the last few years teaching me. And I knew about the Sabbath because my brother's married to a Jewish girl. I always wondered why the Christians were not honoring the Sabbath the way they should. And everything just started clicking. You know, I started sending them donations, you know, and telling them what a good job they're doing over there at 3ABN. And then one day I got a call from them, and they said, hey, why don't you come out and do a cooking show? I said, yeah, I know how to cook, so I'll be glad to do that. So I paid for a ticket and went out there and did a couple cooking shows and flew out there and did a couple more. And then I just got baptized 8 years ago by Jim Gilley over at 3ABN. You know, and God has been using me ever since. But of course, I'm like Isaiah 6:8. You know, send me, I'll go. Amen. Just like you. I mean, I can tell, you know, people have a passion, man. God can do amazing things with people who really want to go. Instead of the people like, oh, well, if you have to use me, go ahead, you know. That's the way people are nowadays, but yeah. And let me tell you, we just did our 1,000th cooking show. It's amazing touring the country how many, I go everywhere. I go to churches that have prison bars on the windows in gang areas. I go to churches. We had a church that I went to. 12 people showed up to the cooking show. And I went to the next church. They were like, oh, that's horrible. 12 people? I said, yeah, but they only had 3 people in their congregation. Official church with 3 people in their congregation. So I thought 12 was a pretty good number. Yeah, you know, and look at this place. I mean, we had more people at the cooking show than you have in here right now. That happens all the time. I was in gang areas down in Atlanta, Georgia. They were dealing drugs 20 yards away from me all day long. And we had 100 people show up to the cooking show. The next year, I went back, same pastor, Pastor Ruff, and he said out of those 100 people that came to that cooking show, 8 people who had never been in a Seventh-day Adventist church before that came to that cooking show were in baptismal classes, and 3 of them had already been baptized. Yeah, never been in a, you know, just came to a cooking show. And then the second time, instead of 100 people, we had 225 people show up. I'm telling you, God does amazing, amazing things through that health message. And it's expensive. I've never charged anybody. I don't charge them for food costs, traveling expenses, anything. Even flying to Hawaii, you know, never charge them for airfares, rent a cars. And God has provided every single step of the way just by contributions. And, you know, so yeah, your contributions definitely help, you know, keep us going. And, I want to share with you a couple things that we need, because I tour the country and I really get the heartbeat of what's going on at different churches and things. And I narrowed it down to a couple things that we need. What we need is a lot more ADD. Now, I'm not talking the ADD that you get from the kids' cereals, okay? That's, you know, not that kind of ADD. We need godly ADD, okay? We need action, we need direction, and we need discernment. Amen? Action, direction, and discernment. It is so critically important to have those things. I mean, action, James 1:22, be ye not just hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. Amen. We've got to have this action, direction, and discernment, because, and that's what's going to help us see the things that are going on in this world today. And a lot of us see it, don't we? But nobody else notices these things. That's why you have to have the action, direction, and discernment. And I'll tell you what, Vegas, I can't even show you the billboards. They're so horrible in Vegas. They've got billboards that say, don't believe the truth. That's all it says. No company name or anything. I've got other ones that say, obey the serpent for a nightclub. Last time my wife and I were in Vegas, they had one nightclub there that had a billboard that said, come worship with, it was a nightclub, come worship with us Thursday nights, the way Vegas prays. You know, this, and luck is everywhere. Luck, luck, luck. I mean, you can't even go to the restroom without somebody wishing you good luck in Vegas. And it's terrible. And by the way, luck was derived from Lucifer to take favor away from God. Yeah, how come every time something good happens in your life, you were lucky? But every time something bad happens in your life, oh, that was from God. That was meant to be. Excuse me? If something bad happens in your life, I guarantee you Satan had something to do with it. And if something good happens in your life, we need to give God the praise and glory and thanks. Amen? Amen. Not be sitting here calling it luck. What does it say in your, is it potluck or fellowship meal here? Is it? we're not having a fellowship today, but I hope it says fellowship meal or something like that. Not, I mean, I'm from Vegas, but I don't want to roll the dice on the meal, okay? And, you know, but, when we were back in Vegas, we had a couple. I had a couple come up to me that knew me from the casino business, and they knew, and I was telling them how much money those slot machines make, and they're like, man, you made that kind of money in that business? You need to get back in that business. And I just looked at them, I said, why would I ever go back to Egypt when I see the promised land right in front of me? Amen? We are this close to the promised land. This is not the time to be running back to Egypt. This is the time to get excited about the future. I'm telling you, action, direction, and discernment. Let me share with you some direction here. This is all going to come together for you, really amazing here. Action, direction, direction. This is Psalms 5:3, because it's a different type of direction. Everybody's always saying, give me direction. It's always about me, me, me. Psalms 5:3 says, my voice you shall hear in the morning, O Lord. In the morning I will direct it to you, and I will look up. That's the kind of direction we need first. We need to direct ourselves to Him and let Him work through us. Let Him do it. But our commitment is to direct ourselves to Him. That's the kind of direction we need. And then discernment is so important. We're going to go a little bit farther to Proverbs 2:3-5. Discernment is so critically important nowadays. Proverbs 2:3-5. Yes, if you cry out for discernment and lift up your voice for understanding, if you seek her as silver and search for her as hidden treasure, then you will understand the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. Pray for discernment. It is that critically important. And let me share with you what an upside down world this is. When you have action, direction, and discernment, you're going to see all of this. And I'm going to go to Hosea 12:6. We'll start with action first here. Let's see, Hosea 12:6. And I know it's right here. Hosea 12:6, because I want to share with you some of these little strategies that Satan does that we need to pay attention to. And one of the things he does is he changes Bibles with different translations and different little words being changed. Now, if you have an NIV Bible, Hosea 12:6 says, "Wait for the Lord." Now, mine right here is a New King James Version. It says, "Wait on your God continually." And then the original meaning says to serve the Lord always. So here's different translations of the Bible going from serving the Lord always to waiting for the Lord. Isn't that kind of like the opposite? Now there is a time to wait for the Lord, amen? But in this particular case, we're supposed to wait on the Lord, like a waiter or waitress waits on somebody in a restaurant, waiting on the Lord with action. That's what we need to do, wait on the Lord, serving the Lord, action, action, action. I know a really amazing thing that a lot of people will enjoy here is this element where everybody's I, me. Look at Philippians 4:13, and I know you all know the scripture, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." That's not the original meaning. You got to take out that word "can." So instead of "I can do all things," it's "I do all things through Christ who strengthens me." What an amazing difference to the meaning of that scripture when you get the "I can" and you put in the "I do." Isn't that amazing? These are the things that slowly chip away. Satan likes to change one word here and one word here. He does things so slowly, nobody ever notices it. You know how he plays that game? It takes sometimes generations to change thought processes. So we've really got to have that discernment to see what he's doing out there. I mean, look at hope. You know, Satan is literally putting people in a state of hope today. Satan is in charge of hope nowadays. Let me share with you. This is really upside down, so you guys are all looking at me funny. Let's see. Oh, I got it right here. Easy. Okay. You got to get this. This is going to blow you away. These are definitions of hope in the Bible. There's some good ones. Boldness, assurance, safety, security. Confidence is a definition of hope, a place of refuge. So there's some good definitions of hope. But these are definitions of hope in the Bible as well. To be careless is a definition of hope. Without care, carelessness. To attach oneself, that's a definition of hope. The folly of relying upon any other type of security strongly contrasted with depending on God alone. So there's bipolar, and it's a definition of hope. One who is overconfident and shows no caution whatsoever. And my favorite definition of hope, an expressed sense of resignation. There is nothing more one can do. Now, doesn't that kind of sound like hopelessness rather than hope? So we've got to understand there's a big difference between hope being a noun, our hope is Jesus Christ, and hope being a verb, which is that earthly, ungodly hope. But Satan bundles it all together. He'll take all the definitions, bundles it all together into one package and says, "All you need is hope. Everything's going to be fine." That's a form of insanity. Now, you know what insanity is, right? Doing the same thing over and over, but expecting a different result. That's what people are doing with hope today. They're hoping the economy changes. They're hoping administrations can do something. They're hoping they get a job without ever looking for a job. They're hoping their health changes without ever changing their lifestyle. This is a false hope that you do not want. You know, is there going to be hope in heaven? No, because we're going to have our hope fulfilled in heaven. Amen? And that's the way we need to be here on earth right now, is having our hope fulfilled, knowing that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior, not hoping that He is our Lord and Savior. Are you catching the differences here? But Satan does this bundling effect. We got to watch out for that bundling effect. Oh, he just messes with so many things in the Bible. Look at faith. There are so many people out there that actually believe that their faith is what saves them. After all, doesn't the Bible say we are saved by faith? If your faith is what saves you, then what do you need a Savior for? You see what I'm talking about here? So there's a big difference between faith in Christ and faith of Christ. Okay, the saving faith is Christ's faith. That's the saving faith. Christ's faith, the covenant that He has with us, that is the saving faith, not of yourself. And in James 2:14, it says, "What is a prophet, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? Can faith save him?" No, not his own faith. It's Christ's faith. So we've got to understand the differences here. Isn't this amazing? But this is what Satan does. I mean, grace is another one of these things. Oh, my word. Grace used to be something so precious and so reverent. And it's just got cheaper and cheaper and cheaper over the generations. Now it's free grace for everybody. Oh man, we are being so bombarded by free grace. I would much rather hear it be called priceless grace. Do you know the price that was paid on the cross for this thing that people in today's society are taking so frivolously instead of giving it the reverence that it deserves? I mean, it has just completely distorted in society. You know, in this younger generation, they're expecting their free grace. They're demanding their free grace. They believe that they get their free grace without ever going to church, without ever praying, without ever reading the Bible, without ever tithing, without ever doing anything. And it just doesn't work that way. You know, so we've got to understand these little tricks that Satan's doing out there. And the reason I'm pointing all this out, to get to the whole picture here, Satan wants to divide and conquer. And as I tour around the country, I find that there's a lot of hope churches. And then there's a lot of grace churches. That's all they teach is grace. Then there's a lot of faith churches. There's a lot of obedient churches. All they teach is obedience. And they're actually Satan's way of dividing to conquer. You divide and conquer. That's what Satan's doing out there. Now, I love to hear a great sermon about grace and a great sermon about love. Love is the next one, by the way, which Ellen White says is the last attack on God. So now you have all these love churches. That's the only thing they will ever teach is love, 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 love. And while I do love to hear some great love sermons, but the thing about it is, we need the whole message. Amen? Amen? You cannot go to heaven without faith. You cannot go to heaven without grace. You cannot go to heaven without obeying God's commandments. This is what I'm talking about. That's why we need the whole message, not bits and pieces of it. And when you get the whole message, that's when you can truly go to a higher level with Christ. You know, and especially if you see the love that was at the cross, you're going to understand God's grace. You're going to understand God's love. You're going to understand Christ's faith all the way through. The whole picture comes together. So you don't want that tunnel vision. You need to open yourself up to the whole Bible and eliminate all these bits and pieces. Does that make sense? Yeah. Right. And that's the way you really get totally fulfilled. Let me see here. I got a fun audience, so I got a couple minutes. I want to share with you a couple things real quick here. This one's going to blow you away. You might know this one. How many of you know, even by a show of hands, how many of you know that it's the saved people who are burning for all eternity? Anybody? I got one. One person, no, two, three, four. Okay, there's a couple people. It's the saved people who are burning for all eternity. Now, you're going to want to go to this, okay? It's Isaiah 33:14. I've got plenty of scriptures. I could do a whole sermon on this. Isaiah 33:14. And this actually answers some questions about eternal hellfire and things like that as well. But Isaiah 33:14. The sinners in Zion are afraid. Fearfulness has seized the hypocrites. Who among us shall dwell with the devouring fire? Who among us shall dwell with everlasting burnings? Here's the answer. He who walks righteously and speaks upright. He who despises the gain of oppressions. Who gestures with his hands refusing bribes. Who stops his ears from hearing bloodshed and shuts his eyes from seeing evil. Let me tell you, shut these televisions off. I mean, it's just a bunch of garbage. I have trouble watching the news in the morning because every commercial is somebody shooting somebody else. It's, oh man. He will dwell on high. His place of defense will be the fortress of rocks. Bread will be given to him and his water will be sure. Now Hebrews 12:29 says God is a consuming fire. Now we are going to be in the presence of this consuming fire for all eternity. But you're never going to be harmed. But we are going to be burning for all eternity. Look at Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Remember when they went through the fiery furnace? They were never harmed because they were in the presence of the Lord. But they were burning in there in the presence of the Lord without ever being harmed. And I'm thinking about this, and I'm like, you know what? If we're going to be burning for all eternity, why don't we be on fire for the Lord now? Amen? Why are we going to wait until Christ returns? We should be on fire for the world now. We should be that bright, shining light into the community that's so hot, that's so bright, that the whole community sees it and says, I don't know what it is about that congregation or that person or that person, but I want some of that. That's the energy that we need. The energy that comes from the Lord that will spark us and ignite us to have that passion. We should all have a passion to serve. In one way or another, every one of us can do something. Yes, get on fire. You got to understand something. I'm not a member of the Laodicea Seventh-day Adventist Church. Okay? I'm not. All right? I'm a member of the Philadelphia Seventh-day Adventist Church. And I could give you a whole sermon about this too, but you got to understand there's so many people saying that they're proud. They have pride in being part of the Laodicea church, the last church before Christ returns. The problem is they're not the only church before Christ returns. Chronologically, it's the last church, but if you go to Revelation, Revelation 3:10 about the Philadelphia church. You should read all of this, but it says, because you have kept my command to persevere, I will also keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those that dwell on the earth. Behold, I am coming quickly. Hold fast to what you have, that no one may take your crown. Let me tell you, we need to be that Philadelphia church. Satan is the one that really created the Laodicea church. I mean, come on. It's giving everybody an excuse. Of course, God knew it was going to happen. That's why he wrote about it. And he's using it. I'll take anything to God's advantage. Laodicea church was able to grow quietly into the fastest growing church on the planet right now, pushing 20 million. We had over 1.1 million baptisms last year alone. That's like one every 2 seconds. I'm telling you, the world is on fire. America is kind of running behind here a little bit. We're the ones that need to get on fire. So, and let me tell you, read more, study more, and pray more. That is the thing I want to close with here. Read more, study more, and pray more. This is from The Great Controversy, page 595. Puts it all in perspective here. The multitudes do not want biblical truth because it interferes with the desires of the sinful, world-loving heart. And Satan supplies the deceptions which they love. But God will have a people upon the earth to maintain the Bible, and only the Bible is the standard of all doctrines and the basis of all reforms. And she continues here, Satan is now putting forth his utmost effort for a final struggle against Christ and his followers. The last great delusion is soon to open before us. Antichrist is to perform him marvelous works in our sight. So closely will the counterfeit resemble the truth that it will be impossible to distinguish between them except by holy scriptures. None but those who have fortified the mind with the truths of the Bible will stand through the last great conflict. And that's where we are. We are going into the last great conflict. And this is the only type of fortification I want. I don't want fortified cereals. I don't want fortified food. But I want a fortified spirit. Read more, study more, pray more. Go to those Sabbath schools. I'm telling you, that's where you get such a good range. Go to Bible studies. Create a Bible study in your home. And even if you only have two or three or four people, you know, learn more. Get that passion that God wants to give you. Amen? Amen. Oh, Lord, Father God, we just thank you so much for this day, and we thank you for the Sabbath that you have given us. And we know this world is developing so many challenges, and that's why we need to turn over everything we have to you. Quit giving you 10%, but give you 100%. Use us in the mightiest ways, as we are here to serve you and love you and know you better. In Jesus' name, amen. And I think we have a closing song too, don't we? Amen.
We sing our hymn of commitment, number 590, Trust and Obey. And on verses 2 and 3, we're going to do something a little different, split it up into men's and women's parts, and it should be on the screen.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey. Not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the sky,
but His smile quickly drives it away.
Not a doubt nor a fear, not a sigh nor a tear.
Trust and obey. Trust.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, and we ask that you go with us into the communities and everywhere we go, and that we not only hold this Sabbath as a day of reverence, but also a day of celebration, a mirror image of that thousand-year Sabbath, that thousand-year celebration that you have awaiting us just around the corner. So we are here to celebrate and love you in Jesus' name. Amen.